Hey guys, hope you're all doing well and keeping safe. Now recently, I have been receiving a lot of messages on how to solve this error message in PHP. I received these messages from people who follow this series I created on how to create a blog with PHP and MySQL database. Now, I have been responding to the messages individually and providing the solutions individually, but I find that it is not very scalable because the messages keep coming and it's a bit exhausting for me to have to respond to everyone individually. So I thought it would be a good idea to create a video addressing this issue so that when I receive any message about this error message, I can just refer the user to this video immediately so that they can learn and understand the error message and then solve it themselves. That way they will not have to wait for my response, which sometimes usually takes days, several hours or days to respond. So in this video we are going to understand the cause of this error message and how to solve it. Now, to solve this particular error message, I am going to give a short answer and a long answer. For the short answer, when you encounter this error message, usually the cause of the error is that your SQL query is either incorrect or has a syntax error, or is correct but it does not correspond to the database table that you are executing it on. So if you want to investigate the particular SQL query that was being executed when you encountered this error, you can just read further and you will see the query in the error message. In this case, we see the query insert into user dot dot dot. So this is an insert query into the user's table. So now we can go to our source code and look for this particular query and investigate it. Okay, so that's the short answer. Let's go to the long answer, which entails recreating this error, investigating the query, and fixing it. So we are on the register.php page. It has a form where users fill in their details, and then they click on the register button. When they click on register, this data gets submitted, and an SQL query will be created, which we have already written, will receive this data and then execute on our MySQL database with this data to create our user. So the register.php page, if you open our source code, is found in the root folder of our application. So this is the code for the form. When the user clicks on the register, like I said, the data gets submitted and eventually an SQL query will be executed, and that query is inside our db.php file. So the data will be submitted to this function called create, and the create function takes two parameters. One is the table name, the name of the table on which we want to execute our query. And the second parameter is the data that we want to execute with that query. The table here is going to be users. Now the form was submitted to the controllers file, and the controllers file then invoked this function, passing in the users as the table and then the data from the form as the data to be executed on that table. I am going to show you the users controller file in a minute, but I just left it out because it's not very necessary at this point. So now when we receive the data that has been submitted from the register form and the name of the table that we want to execute that query on, we have all the data that we need to insert the user record in the user's table. So we generate a query and then we pass that query alongside the data to another function that actually executes that query on our MySQL database. So what we are doing now is we are trying to investigate the query. So I am just going to do what I normally do when I want to find out the value inside a variable. So we want to find the value of our SQL query that has been generated here. And then to make our work easier, we are just going to find out the value of the data that is going to be added to this query in the execute query function to be stored in the database. Now, the code is working properly as it is now. So if we attempt to register, everything will work fine. But what we want to do is to recreate that particular error message and then fix it. So now I am going to deliberately change the key here, the name value here for username to be name instead of username, because this is usually what our viewers of my series, of the blog series, usually do, and it lands them into that particular error message. So maybe for their particular use case, they want this to be called name instead of username. So they change it like this. And as we have changed it like this, let us go and execute and submit a new user. So we click on register, and we have not yet executed the query. Remember, we actually captured the data here and displayed it on the browser, and then ended execution of the entire program here. So this is the query that our create function actually formed. And then this is the data that is going to be sent to the query. We are using prepared statements here. And the way prepared statements work is, we first of all create our query, and instead of putting the data in that query, we just place some placeholders in the query. So the query goes to the database, and the database does what it does in a step that we refer to as preparing the SQL statement. When it has prepared the statement, our program will send another request again to the database, this time passing the data to the database. This step we refer to as the execution step. So you prepare your query, and then you execute your query. Now, when we send this to our database attempts to prepare it. And if you look at the keys here, our user's table doesn't have a name column. So here is our user's table. You see username, admin, password, and the rest, but you don't see a name column. So we can already predict that this query, although it has the correct syntax, it does not correspond to the user's table that we are attempting to execute it on. And so if we remove these statements and then we submit our form again, it will get executed in our database, and our database will spit out this error because the bind param step failed. It did not prepare the statements. So when we try to bind the variables or the values onto our SQL statement, it failed. So let's look at this execute query function. So the first step it does is it prepares the statement, and then it returns a statement object that has some values as well as functions attached to it. One of those functions is the bind param, which now puts the values into our SQL that we did earlier with placeholders instead of actual values. And then when it does that, it executes the query. So this statement, instead of returning an object with functions on it, it returns false. And when we are trying to bind param on false, remember false does not have any function called bind param. False is just a primitive value, so it doesn't have any functions on it. So when we attempt to call bind param on it, it says, it gives that error that you see. Okay, so that might feel like a lot of explanation for a simple solution. So now, how do we solve this issue? So the best way to solve it is to make sure that the keys that we specify in the name attribute here should correspond to the columns in the database. So here we replace it with username, and we make sure that the spelling we have here is the exact same spelling we have in the database. If you put a capital letter for the letter U here, we are still going to experience the same error, because username with small letter U is not the same as username with capital letter U. So this is going to work for all the forms that you come across. Make sure that the keys here correspond to the keys or the columns in the database. So now that we have changed back to username, if we refresh our form and submit again, this time it works. Actually, I didn't intend for it to create a new user. I wanted to observe the keys and make sure that. So let's try to submit another user again. Okay, so now you see username here, and it corresponds to the username here. So if you submit the form, it is going to work. And sometimes viewers want to add another column here, and when they add the column on the form here, let's say they want to add the phone number. Let the initial value just be empty. When they do this, they forget to create a column on that user's table called phone, and they go and attempt to submit. When you do that, again, you will be having a column in your query called phone, but we don't have that phone here. So the solution to this case, if you want to add a field, is to also create the column in the table. So let's just make it appear after the username. Just make sure you create, again, this value here has to be the same as the name attribute, the value for the name attribute. So it's a varchar, let's just say it's 13 letters. And now when we attempt to create a user, by the way, I disabled validation, so even if we submit an empty value here, it will work. I didn't just want it to disrupt the flow of the video. So when we do that, it works because we have a phone here. So that is basically how you solve the issue. So a recap of this is, whichever form you happen to be using, whenever you see that error, you should investigate the keys that are being sent to create an SQL query, and make sure that they correspond to the column names in the database. So I hope that this video helps you to solve that particular problem when you come across it.